Welcome, everybody. Thanks for sticking around, right? So first of all, I want to have an acknowledgement to Methodist and Ali, because part of the slides that I used were his. You know, we never develop anything de novo. We always add on to everybody else, and so I wanted to thank him. I don't have any disclosures, and if I did, I wasn't going to tell you. Carl did a very nice explanation. Thoracic outlet syndrome, it's a symptomatic compression of the neurovascular bundle at the thoracic outlet, right? That's the diagnosis, but you've got to use that diagnosis to try and find out when a patient walks into your office and gives you this non-specific complaint of arm pain, right? It's only going to happen in a very small degree of population of your patients. The age range is 25 to 40, and women are more common than men. And again, the idea about the diagnosis, they just don't walk in and say, hey, I got a TOS, you know, take out my rib, you know, do all the tests, right? They come in with these nonspecific symptoms, and you're going to have to develop a pattern recognition in your practice to find out about these symptoms, because they're difficult patients to deal with, because they've already been to somebody before they even got to you, and you have to figure this out, right? It's just not as simple, I got rest pain, I have multi-level disease, I need a femtib. It's not like that with TOS. So you got to do a good history. You have to know the symptoms and the signs. You have to examine them appropriately. And then you have to recommend the appropriate studies, right? I'm not going to go over the anatomy because Carlos did a very nice job. But the point is that there are three spaces that are possible etiologies for the compression. And you have to be aware of those. And all the diagnostic tests are based on those three areas. Scalene triangle, the costal clavicular space, and I do believe that the retropectoralis minor space probably is a pretty significant contributor to either unfounded success or failure of the procedure. Okay? So some of the pathology and pathophysiology, just to reiterate, previous trauma, inflammation, spasm, fibrotic reactions, low-grade repetitive trauma that doesn't make any sense lifestyle-wise, but in the end, the cumulative repetitiveness causes the problem. You have age-related postural changes. People who in the beginning were standing straight up are now drooping, right? And then you have the congenital variations of the three compression spaces. Again, not to belabor it, neurogenics most common, then venous, and then arterial. But the symptoms are really odd. There's a wide, broad range of severity. They can be mild to completely disabling. They're insidious. You try and find a pattern and talk to them from beginning to end, it's hard to figure it out. There's no stepwise fashion. Sometimes they'll be good, also on the next day or the next month, they're terrible. Gradual increase in severity, not always, is my experience, and again related to trauma and muscle spasm. So the neurogenic is the most common, and you ought to break it up into lower brachial plexus versus upper brachial plexus in regard to how they present to you. Sensory disturbance in the lower brachial plexus involves the ulnar nerve and the fourth and fifth fingers, pain, paresthesias, subjective coldness and weakness. Also, anterior, posterior shoulder, as opposed to the upper brachial plexus sensory disturbance, which is mainly forearm and upper arm. And you know, you need to know your brachial plexus anatomy to know that. Pain in the side of the neck, headache, occipital, orbital, but not frontal. Somebody who presents with frontal pain does not have TOS until proven otherwise. You can get secondary spasm of the trapezius and the paraspinal muscles. Venous, how do they present? Swelling, edema, cyanosis, hand and arm, discomfort aggregated with exercise, forearm fatigue, enlarged collateral veins, sudden onset of symptoms. They were okay in the morning. By the time the night rose, my hand's swollen. Paget-Schroeder effort vein thrombosis. How about arterial? Digital or hand ischemia, emboli, petechiae, ulcerations, forearm claudication. All the symptoms that present, we have tests to assess whether or not this is occurring with exercise. As Carlos said, a pulsatile supraclavicular mass or bruise suggesting a subclavian artery aneurysm distal to the trauma or the stenosis. You should ask about how do their symptoms, are they exasperated? Elevation of arms and hands, do they reach when they reach overhead? Do their symptoms get worse? How about when lifting, prolonged typing, driving on the computer, speaking on the phone, combing their hair? when I was at the University of Washington, I had a 25-year-old co-ed from the University of Washington who basically got it only when she was combing her hair and nothing else. We had to lyse her, decompress her rib, and she was very grateful, but it was a very odd thing, and she was a typically normal appearing person and everything else. Didn't have any other issues other than when she was combing her hair, brushing her hair. So in summary, from the clinical diagnosis, because this talk is about evaluation and diagnosis of the patient, it's difficult. You have to spend some time with them. It's not like, sir, you have an abdominal aortic aneurysm, you have a 2-centimeter neck, and you have a 2-centimeter landing zone in your iliacs, we're going to put an EVAR in. Thank you. Here's the nurse. Here's the physician. Let's get the consent. You have to spend some time with them. Again, the symptoms are disabling, vasospasm, disuse edema. They can get hypersensitive. They've already seen multiple physicians, and they're going to question everything you tell them because it'll probably be different than everything else they've heard. A lot of them, you have to be very careful, is that they have medical legal issues going on maybe at work. They're trying to get disability compensation. And patients are frustrated. And the bottom line, we're in here to take care of patients, not to do a good operation. Let's just be very clear about that. The secondary benefit of this specialty is that you get to do great operations, but you get to take care of patients and make them better. And you have to really have a very good overall clinical assessment of them, right? You have to spend some time with these people. It takes up a lot of your time. So how about the physical exam? You want to focus on the neck and the shoulder, arms and hands, their cyanosis, blanching, discoloration, and spasm. Identify the trigger points, maybe the anterior scalene muscle. Peripheral nerve exams, you got to rule out ulnar nerve entrapment, carpal tunnel, cubital tunnel, and you want to test their strength and their weakness. The original maneuver was from Adson, and it was in SGO, published in 1947, where you compress the radial and the area over the anterior scalene, keep their arm down, have them turn their head to the same side. Not very specific, but you need to know the history of how you examine folks this way, and that'll reproduce their symptoms. And you'll get a loss of pulse of the radial pulse, because that's compression of the subclavian artery. And you can see there the way it would happen is that as the arm is brought down, it's brought down flush, the head's turned, compressing the space in the scalene triangle, obliterating the pulse. So the maneuvers and the diagnosis have an anatomic and physiologic basis. This is the Wright's test, which is where you elevate the arm and you turn the head the other way, again, forcing compression of the structures in the three compression spaces. Again, associated with, but not totally specific or sensitive. The elevated arm test, or the Roos test, is the loss of pulse with the arm straight up, and this is an old thing with a non-invasive plethysmographic test. You can do that in the non-invasive vascular lab. Here's an example. This is from Ali's talk from a couple years ago. Rapid opening and closing of your fist reintroduces the symptoms. One, if it's bad enough, your pulse goes away and the plethysmograph doesn't show a pulse. So the other one, you have to open and close, and it reproduces it. You should only do that up to 3 minutes. Here's another test, which is called the shoulder abduction, which some of they bring their shoulders back and drop their thing, and it actually compresses the space between the clavicle and first rib. And you can see where that would be compressing it here and there. So again, anatomic basis for some of these maneuvers. The electrophysiologic tests. Electromyography is almost always normal because it tests motor function, and TOS is a sensory problem. Nerve conduction velocities, F-wave responses, and somatosensory evoked potentials, all historical value. I'm not sure how valuable they are in today's world. You need to have a pretty good differential diagnosis when you're trying to diagnose these folks. Cervical spine disorders, neurologic disorders, the musculoskeleton. You have to have that in your bag, in your armamentarium, to be able to exclude all of those, because the TOS many times is a diagnosis of exclusion. How about anatomic studies? Well, chest x-ray, you want to rule out cervical rib. You want to rule out a wide transverse process at C7. CT and MRI, you want to be able to exclude other conditions, other solid conditions, other conditions that could be compressive or moving. And then your arteriography and your viography and positional maneuvers is really many times the best way to assess both the arterial and venous issues. Scalene muscle block again, roll out the cervical rib. Oh, that's the wrong slide, so I'm going to just keep moving on that one. So here's an example of thoracic for an angiogram. You would think that the slide on the left, it would all be normal, and his hand on the right is in a normal position on the table. When actuality, you have to abduct their hand and move it out for compression on the arterial. You can see that. I didn't want to do that. And you can see that it's compressing on that bottom right thing, the subclavian artery at the point of compression on the claustroclavicular space. Sometimes the angiogram, when you do it, will show you a subclavian artery aneurysm. And you look at that and you think, boy, it looks pretty good. I got my diagnosis and I don't need to do anything else. And maybe I don't need to select it out and do a right selective upper extremity angiogram, when in fact you do. Because more than likely you're going to get embolization from that supraclavicular subclavian artery aneurysm, and you're going to get a loss of either the radial or the ulnar or the interosseous artery. In this case, the bottom right is the loss of the radial artery due to embolization. How about venous duplex? Well, duplex will show you, if somebody presents with a swollen arm, you can show that there's thrombosis in the venous outflow tract. And again, this is a venogram that's from the periphery showing that multiple areas of thrombosis through that, both in the axillary vein and it looks like occlusion in the subclavian vein. Again, this is not a great slide, but you can see there's, if you look close enough, you can see some thrombus there. And then you've got the effort vein thrombosis, which is Paget-Schroeder disease, where, again, thrombus is noted here within a normal vein, but it's in the axillary subclavian junction in the subclavian vein. Now, we talk about the pec minor instead of the pec major. This is an example where, in a provocative move, you're going to have actually compression of both the brachial and the cephalic veins on venography, and you can actually see that tapered stenosis of both veins and their outflow, and which would give you a clue that maybe is that retro pec minor space is causing the symptoms, in this case for venous TOS. Here's an MRV showing, again, a very diseased ratty vein with thrombus. So another way to evaluate it is using digital IV angiogram, where you're actually injecting contrast into the venous system, but then using the actual position that they have symptoms at on the bottom right that shows the area of narrowing in the artery. This is another example, and again, this is another central venography coming from the groin and shooting a central venogram. I only have 10 seconds, so I'm going to push here. Really not going to get into upper extremity disease because I think we should have concentrated on TOS. So basically, upper extremity, they're all multiple. Oops, I'm done. Thank you, guys. That's all I got.